honestly, prior to the early 20th century, the pharmaceutical industry was like the Wild West. There was basically no rules. You could make drugs that had all kinds of compounds like cocaine, morphine, heroin, cannabis, chloroform. Some of these very dangerous or highly addictive compounds were very common.
I'm in the somewhat Wild West, and as I go about my days in the 37th month of this pandemic, I find myself thinking about modern medicine constantly. In the past 100 years, we've gone from a point where we had this blind faith in medicine to a different point where trust in science and medicine is eroding. And my question is, why? Why did we go from a place where we would give cocaine lollipops to our children for a toothache to being hesitant to receive a preventative vaccine? And what does this all say about the psychology of trust? This video is sponsored by the album Music for Scientists. You can listen now on your preferred music service. To get some perspective, I want to travel back in time to the days when smoking was prescribed for asthma, beer for diabetes, and methamphetamines for weight loss. But before I re-emerge into the universe, I have to take part in the ceremonious COVID-19 pre-production ritual. Negative. It's negative.
I am the nerd who takes care of the old drugs. I think that's my official title.
This is Stephen Hall, whose official title is the Curator of the History of Pharmacy Museum at the University of Arizona.
The truth is, most of what we have here is what you might call old science. These treatments often lacked the scientific rigor that we would see today, where there was not always, you know, hardline academic research done. There was not always proper testing done. Honestly, prior to the early 20th century, the pharmaceutical industry was like the Wild West. There was basically no rules. Everyone knows about old Coca-Cola, that it used to contain cocaine. Well, sure, the fact is lots of things did at the time.
It's easy to look back with our 21st century perspective and gasp that cocaine was practically the high fructose corn syrup of the old times. But back then, a lot of guesswork and trial and error were part of life, as was trust in the person who did that guesswork. They were the keeper of knowledge and part of the community.
In the present day, there's a great separation in the health science professions. You have pharmacy, which is distinct from medicine, which is distinct from nursing and ophthalmology and dentistry, and these are all their own insular professions. 100 years ago, that was really not the case. There was much more overlap between the professions. And the reason for this was often in small rural towns, especially out here in the West. The West was a rough, rugged terrain. There was not nearly as much development as there was out in the older part of the country. And so if there was a pharmacist in a community, in many cases, a pharmacist may have been the only medical professional in a whole community. And so by necessity, the pharmacist then would have acted as the doctor or the dentist, because if there was no other option, that person would be your best bet.
And a lot of this blind faith in old medicine comes down to the existence of this one medical professional. So trust researcher Rachel Botsman coined this idea of a trust stack, these layers that are necessary for people to act, change their behavior, or jump into the unknown. The first layer of the stack is the idea. Let's say, in this case, that we need to protect against infectious disease. The next layer is the platform, which can be technology or organizations. And in the final layer, you need to trust individuals, so other people. 100 years ago, there were far fewer layers to this stack that people needed to trust. Of course, there was the idea, so to get better or prevent against infectious disease. And then there was the individual, often the one medical professional that you turn to. But fast forward to the 2020s and this trust stack has expanded. There's still the idea, but then the platform has expanded to include government organizations, pharmaceutical companies, and advanced technology. And there's a whole host of medical professionals down the chain. Where there used to only be a couple of layers required for us to trust something, now there are many. All that's needed to break trust is a crack in one of these layers. Perhaps someone who is vaccine hesitant believes in the idea of preventing disease, but they distrust their doctor. Or what is more likely is that they distrust government organizations or pharmaceutical companies, or they're concerned about what's in the advanced technology that is delivering the vaccine. And the prevalence of this lack of trust is pretty alarming. The latest figures indicate that more than one third of American adults would not get a vaccine to prevent COVID-19. Even when our medical knowledge has come such a long way in a pretty short amount of time. So how can we rebuild trust?
The very first vaccine was actually what's called an inoculation. People would take pus from one of the eruptions and put it onto somebody else, maybe in an open wound. And people did this willingly. They risked getting full-blown smallpox in the hopes that they would only get it a little bit bad and develop immunity for it. And that's how this, you know, rapid vaccine development sort of came to be.
This is my friend Cara Santamaria, a science journalist, podcaster, and healthcare worker who's recently received the COVID-19 vaccine. I wanted to know what it was all like.
Did it hurt?
Interestingly, the needle, the jab itself, you didn't really even feel it. But then when I got home, I'd say for the first dose, it was about an 8-hour delay. And that's when I started to feel some pretty intense injection site soreness. That lasted about 3 days. And I would say that that was comparable to getting punched really hard in the arm. The second dose was a completely different story. I'd say it took about 12 hours, and that's when I started to experience pretty severe symptoms that are absolutely normal, but pretty intense responses to the vaccine itself. They're often described as flu-like symptoms. I had a fever, joint pain.
Is that fairly common?
Yeah, so there, all of the vaccine studies publish side effects. This is a normal immune response to the vaccine.
What I found fascinating was Cara's cognitive response to the side effects.
And so one thing that was weird for me, I have to tell you, Vanessa, during the experience is cognitively, I knew I didn't have COVID, of course, and I definitely didn't have the flu. I had no pathogen in my body that my body was fighting off. But for all intents and purposes, it felt the same. And so it was such a weird thing to be like, this is my immune system telling me that I just had an invader in the wrappings of a vaccine. I'm perfectly safe, I'm perfectly healthy, but I feel ill because this is my body mounting a response so that in the future, if I'm exposed to COVID-19, I'll recognize it and be able to fight it off. It also gives you some really good insight into how much of feeling crappy when you're sick is your immune system responding.
So even with this awareness of what the vaccine is doing, we can still be concerned and even panic and be fearful, which is often the part of the story that gets shared publicly, which then leads some of those 39% of people who won't get the COVID-19 vaccine to question if it's safe.
But what we know now is that we've figured out how to vaccinate safely, efficiently, effectively, and with minimal, I'm talking almost non-existent harm. And we have these short memories. It's really hard for us to put ourselves in the shoes of our parents, our grandparents, our great-grandparents, who lived every day with the specter that probably one of their many children, or more than one of their many children, were gonna die. They were going to die of early childhood diseases. They were even going to die during childbirth. That's just unheard of now. That's seen as a medical failure. It's just a different time we live in, and it's so important that we maintain that perspective.
With time and more information, we seem to have forgotten the real and dire consequences of the past. It's important to note that people were still questioning of old medicine, which is always good. But we didn't have hesitancy at the level we do today, when vaccines are safer than ever.
In this age of COVID-19, and with this rollout of the vaccine that is already saving lives and will only continue to do so, it is interesting to kind of look back and say, how did we get here? And what groundwork was laid with some of these older ideas?
And while medicine has some interesting old practices, we have come so far in the past 100 years. We have made so many advancements. thanks to science. But we're also at a point where trust is fractured in science. So if you are lucky enough to have access to the COVID-19 vaccine, please talk about it. Please talk about the process of getting it. One way that we can rebuild trust is through humanity, through empathy, and through telling our stories. And as we move past this challenging point in history, past the 81st month of the pandemic, what we can do is something that has got us through challenging times before. We can trust in the process of science. We can trust experts, and we can trust each other just a little bit more. And I trust that you will enjoy listening to the new album, Music for Scientists, which is the sponsor of today's video. Music for Scientists is an artistic tribute to science and the work of scientists. The album was created by Patrick Olson, who was actually one of my first patrons, so it is cool that I now have the opportunity to shout out Patrick's work. You can watch the music videos over on their YouTube channel, which I will link to right here, or you can stream the album from your preferred music service. Thanks for watching.